Good morning, students. Today we are doing second chapter from our Hornbill books. We are not afraid to die if we can all be together, by Gordon Cook and Alan East. It is an adventure story of extreme courage and skill exhibited by Gordon Cook, his family and crewmen in the face of great adversity, as they battle to save their ship and their lives. Students, as I'm going to do line by line explanation of the chapter, this image of a yacht and its parts will help you with many, many things to understand what are the things in the boat that the crewman or Gordon Cook is using to make the boat stabilize in the sea. So this image will speak about what is a jib, what is the mainsail, what is mast, what is stern. So as you go through the reading of the chapter, keep checking this image time and again for a clear understanding of the terms used. We are not afraid to die if we can all be together. In July 1976, my wife Mary, son Jonathan 6, daughter Suzanne 7, and I set sail from Plymouth, England to duplicate the round-the-world voyage made 200 years earlier by Captain James Cook. Now, the narrator Gordon Cook tells us that how he and his wife decided that they desire to duplicate, that is to imitate, to copy the sea voyage done by James Cook, and Captain James Cook done the sea voyage 200 years earlier. So the narrator in July 1976, along with his wife Mary, son Jonathan, who is 6 years old, daughter Suzanne, who is 7 years old, they set sail. They started for a sea voyage from Plymouth, England, to duplicate, to copy, to imitate the round the world voyage made 200 years earlier by Captain James Cook. So the route that Captain James Cook took to do this world voyage, similar route the narrator took. For the longest time, Mary and I, a 37-year-old businessman, had dreamt of sailing in the wake of the famous explorer. So this was a dream not only of the narrator but his wife also, that they dreamt. They dreamt what? That they would be sailing. They would be sailing exactly how the famous explorer Captain James Cook did. And I stands for the narrator, who's a businessman. So they had a dream to go for this sea voyage and to imitate Captain James Cook route of the world around the world voyage. And for the past 16 years, we had spent all our leisure time honing our seafaring skills in British waters. So he says that how 16 years they spent, which time? Leisure time, that is the spare time, whenever they got time, 16 years they spent honing, that is sharpening, our seafaring skills, that is traveling by sea in British waters. So it's not easy for anyone to just plan a visit and go and set about in any of the ship or a boat and go for a sea journey. No, you need to get used to the high seas. You need to get to understand that there might be a seasickness to any family member. So it needs to be improve, that is seafaring skills need to be improved. So they took whenever they got their leisure hours, they used to practice in the sea, in the British waters, sailing over there with all sorts of weather to understand what situations they might face if they are going to go for round the world voyage, and what situations will come and how they are going to tackle the same. So they use 16 years to practice 16 years for their sharpening their skills at the waters. Our boat Waywalker, a 23-meter, 30-ton wooden hulled beauty, had been professionally built. So he tells us about his boat, which boat they took, Waywalker. Waywalker is 23-meter, 30-ton. wooden hull, that is the body of the ship is wooden, had been professionally built, that is the efficient people, professional people have made that boat, and we had spent months fitting it and out and testing it in the roughest weather we could find. So 16 years when they were practicing to get adapted to the water, to get adapted to the situations on the surface of the seas, to get adapted to the things or problems they might face with weathers, with anything, with their health, anything. So when they were learning this, he says that with wave walker we practice, he says we had spent months fitting it out and testing it, that is various fixtures were done on wave walker, and we have tested wave walker also in roughest weather, roughest waters in British water. 16 years they've used this boat to understand every bit of the technicalities on sea if they go for this sort of journey. We could find the first leg of our planned 3-year 105,000 kilometers journey past presently. So he says that this was a 3-year journey, that is round the world voyage is a 3 years plan, and the first phase of it, that is 105,000 kilometer journey, was pleasant and smooth, no problems, no hindrances, nothing went wrong. As we sailed down to the west coast of Africa to Cape Town, so it says from Africa to Cape Town, this first phase of the journey was beautiful. There, before heading east, we took on two crewmen, American Larry Vigil and Swiss Herb Ziegler, to help us tackle one of the world's roughest seas, the Southern Indian Ocean. So it says that there miss at Cape Town, before heading to east direction, we took on two crewmen, that is they hired two crewmen. One was an American, that is Larry Vigil, and the other was Swiss, that is Herb Ziegler. And they took these crewmen, why? Because they were to head to the world's roughest seas, that is Southern Indian Ocean. So they would be a big help while going for this journey. On our second day out of Cape Town, we began to encounter strong gales. Now it says that when we moved from Cape Town, when our journey started from Cape Town, the second day of it, we began to face strong gales, that is winds, strong ferocious winds. For the next few weeks, they blew continuously. Now it says that this strong winds were blowing for the coming weeks also. Few weeks it blew. Gales did not worry me, but the size of the waves was alarming. So when these winds are blowing, strong winds are blowing, they did not worry me. But with the wind, the waves were rising, and the size of the waves was really dangerous. Up to 15 meters as high as our main mast. So it says the size of the waves were as high as our main mast. Main mast, students, is a tall upright pole on the ship or a boat. So it says 15 meters high was the height, was the of the size of the waves. December 25 found us 3,500 kilometers east of Cape Town. It says 25th December, that is Christmas time, they were 3,500 kilometers to Cape Town. Despite atrocious weather, we had a wonderful holiday complete with a Christmas tree. Though the weather was cruel, it was bad, but then they had enjoyed their beautiful holiday. A Christmas tree was made on the boat and they had a good time. New Year's Day saw no improvement in the weather, but we reasoned that it had to change soon. And then New Year came, there was no change in the weather. The strong winds were blowing, with winds the waves were rising, but things were understood. It was understood that yes, the weather would definitely change, and it did change for the worse, and the weather became more bad, it became worsened. At dawn on January 2, the waves were gigantic. So early morning January 2, the waves were very huge. We were sailing with only a small storm jib and were still making 8 knots. So he says that we were sailing with a small storm jib. Jib, students, is a small triangular sail in front of the main sail or main mast. So he says that we were sailing with this storm jib and the wind was, and we were still making 8 knots. That is the speed. The knots is a unit of speed. It was 8. As the ship rose to the top of each wave, we could see endless enormous seas rolling towards us. So as the waves was moving to fro. So at the top of the wave, when their wave walker was on the top of the wave, they felt as if from around the sea, enormous seas are rolling towards them. And the screaming of the wind, that is the noise of the wind, the roaring of the wind and spray, that is the droplets that were falling onto them, was painful to the ears, and that was dangerous. It was a sign that yes, it is going to become more worse. The weather will become more bad now. To slow the boat down, we dropped the storm jib. Now they had to stabilize the boat. They had to make sure that they maintain the stability. So they removed the storm jib, dropped it, and lashed a heavy mooring rope. Lashed, that is to fasten a heavy mooring rope in a loop across the stern. Stern is, that is the back end of the boat. So they took the rope. Students, mooring rope is a rope that they usually use to tie the boat so that the boat does not flow in the water. So they took that huge mooring rope and they made a loop, and that loop was tied to the stern, that is the back end of the boat. Then we double lashed everything, and then everything they occupied and protected with the rope went through our life raft drill. Life raft drill is a small rubber boat. Attach a lifelines, that is ropes. Donned means put on oilskins, that is waterproof jackets, and life jackets, and waited. So this is how they prepared themselves. They realized that the weather is going to be very poor now. Any minute the waves would hit their wave walker. So they prepared. They double lashed, double secured everything with the mooring rope, and then they checked on the rubber boats. They attached the ropes and they wore waterproof jackets, and they waited for worse to happen. The first indication of impending disaster came at about 6 p.m. So the first indication came that yes, the disaster would be there, and it was 6 p.m. in evening with an ominous silence, that is unpleasant silence. There was silence all around, quiet. The wind dropped, the wind stopped blowing, and the sky immediately grew dark. So there was darkness all around. Then came a growing roar, and an enormous cloud towered aft of the ship. Aft, that is above the ship. So they saw that there was a roaring sound, and this roaring sound there was a huge cloud very close to the ship, aft above the ship or close to the ship. With horror, I realized that it was not a cloud but a wave like no other I had ever seen. So the narrator notices this cloud. He sees the darkness and he notices, no, he was wrong. It was not a cloud. It was a wave, a very huge, enormous wave. It appeared perfectly vertical. It appeared very straight up on the heads and almost twice the length of the other waves. So other waves were 15 meters, but then it was a huge wave. So it could be understood more than 15, 30, 35 meters high with a frightful breaking crest. And the wave was ready to break. That breaking crest, that is the top of the wave. It was frightful. It was dangerous to stuck the ocean or stuck the wave walker. The roar increased to a thunder as the stern moved up the face of the wave, and for a moment I thought we might ride over it. And he says the roar increased to a thunder, and then there was this roaring sound became thunderous, and the stern moved up to the face of the wave, and the stern was moving along with the wave. As the wave was all together straight up over there, it similarly the wave walker was moving.
and for a moment I thought we might ride over it, and then he felt that this wave, if we are going to be this wave walker would be in enveloped with this wave. But then a tremendous explosion shook the deck, and then there was a huge explosion, a huge bang, a large explosion shook the deck, that is the floor of the ship. And then this wave that was looking frightful with the breaking crash stuck on the deck of the ship. That is, there was a tempest on the sea. A torrent of green and white water broke over the ship, and everywhere there was stream of water, green, white, everywhere the ship was surrounded, or the ship had water in. My head smashed into the wheel, and he hit his head hit the wheel, and I was aware of flying overboard, and he was conscious that yes, he had been thrown in the water with that huge explosion and sinking below the waves, and he was sinking in the sea. I accepted my approaching death. Now he realized he is in the sea waters. He had to accept death, because with the tempest in the sea, nothing could happen. He can't save himself. And as I was losing consciousness, I felt quite peaceful. And then he felt peaceful because he was losing consciousness, because death is peaceful. So he says that he accepted that he would die. Unexpectedly, my head popped out of water, and then suddenly what happened? His head came out of water. He lifted his head out of the water. A few meters away, wave walker was near capsizing. He is in the sea. The tempest has hit the sea, and he sees from the water surface, he sees wave walker, and he sees that it was near, it will overturn. Her mast almost horizontal. Her stands for wave walker. Mast almost horizontal. It seemed that wave walker is going to drown now. It was horizontal. The mast was horizontal. Then a wave hurled her upright. My lifeline jerked taut. And then an enormous wave came and threw violently the wave walker, and the wave walker was again straight on the surface of the sea. My lifeline jerked taut, and he felt that his lifeline that he was wearing, it became very tight. I grabbed the guardrails, so he's helping himself with the guardrails. Students, guardrails are like fences at the edge of the boat or a ship, so that nobody falls down. So he gets those guardrails, he swims and comes to that guardrail, catches one, and sails through the air into the wave walker's main boom front. So he comes inside in the wave walker. Subsequently, waves toss me around the deck like a rag doll. So with each wave, he is tossing like a rag doll from here to there on the deck of the ship. My left ribs cracked, my mouth filled with blood and broken teeth, and there was injuries on him. His ribs cracked. There was blood on his mouth. The blood was flowing, and then his teeth were broken. Somehow I found the wheel, lined up the stern for the next wave, and hung on. And somehow he got hold of the wheel, and he waited for the next wave, and he hung on. That is, waited. Water everywhere. I could feel that the ship had water below, but I dared not abandon the wheel to investigate. Now there was everywhere on the deck water all around, and he knew somewhere water is there below also, but then he can't dare to abandon, to leave the wheel to investigate how much water is there on the ship. Suddenly the front hatch was thrown open and Mary appeared. "We are sinking," she screamed. "The decks are smashed. We are full of water." So suddenly what happened? The hatch door opened. That is a kind of a door on the floor of the ship or a boat. So it was thrown open and a wife appears, and she is screaming. She cries aloud that the boat is going to sink. The decks are smashed, and there is everywhere water around on the ship. Take the wheel, I shouted as I scrambled for the hedge. So the narrator asked wife to handle, to take care of the wheel, and then he scrambled. Scramble means to move quickly using hands and legs. Why? Because there's water all around. So he's fighting to go through the hedge to get hold of it. Why fighting? Because there is a storm. And then it the wave is not this the wave walker is not static, it's not stable, it's moving with to and fro with the flow of the waves. So he has to scramble to go to the hatch. Larry and Herb were pumping like madmen. So Larry and Herb, both of them, started pumping the water that was coming in the wave walker. So they started pumping like madmen, crazy people. Broken timbers hung at crazy angles. So broken timbers, that is the broken wood, were here and there hanging badly. The whole starboard side is a right hand side, bulged inward, that is to stick out, like when a vehicle meets with an accident. So what happened, the body of the vehicle is thrust inwards. Similar happened with the boat also. So the starboard side is, the body has been stuck inside. Clothes, crockery, jars, tins and toys sloshed about in deep water. So whatever they were carrying, the things, eatables, clothes, charts, everything, it was moving in the water. Slosh means move in the water here and there. What water? Deep water on the surface of the sea. I half swam, half crawled into the cabins, children's cabin. So he's fighting to go to the children's cabin, swimming and crawling. Are you all right? I asked. So he questions kids. He investigates if both of them are good. Yes, they answered from an upper bunk. So the kids were lying on the upper bed. They have taken a safe position. Why? There was water all around. So they took the upper bed and they said yes. But my head hurts a bit, said Sue, pointing to a big bump above her eyes. So the daughter Suzanne says that the head is hurting. Why? Because there was a huge injury above the eye. Bump means injury. It was swollen. I had no time to worry about bumped heads. Now the narrator, he was helpless. He wanted to save everyone. So he did not have time to see to the injury of the daughter. After finding a hammer, screws and canvas, I struggled back on deck. So he gets all the things and goes to the deck with the starboard side bashed open. That was hit hard badly. Starboard side, that is the right hand side of the boat. We were taking water with each wave that broke over us. So with every wave, the water was coming in the boat. If I couldn't make some repairs, we would surely sink. So if he's not going to do some repairing work, but then the wave walker would sink. Somehow I managed to stretch canvas and secure waterproof hatch covers across the gaping holes. So wherever the gaping holes were there, gaps were there, he stretched those canvas and waterproof cover so that with each wave, whatever the water was coming, at least some certain amount of water could be stopped. Some water continued to stream below. Somewhere the water was there, but most of it was now being deflected over the side. But now the water changed, deflected means changed direction. More problem arose when a hand pump started to block up with the debris flowing around the cabins and the electric pump short circuited. Now there were problems that were multiplying. Now the other problem that started was the hand pumps were getting blocked. With the debris flowing, waste all around. Now what was the waste? The waste of clothes, crockery, charts, tin, toys, whatever things they were carrying, they were flowing from here to there like a rag doll. So they were flowing and they were blocking the process of the water to be thrown out. And the electric pump short-circuited, so the electric pump was of no use. The water level rose threateningly and the water level was rising. Back on deck, I found that our two spare hand pumps had been wrenched overboard. Wrenched overboard, that is pulled violently. So he notices that they were carrying spare hand pumps also, but then both of the spare hand pumps were on the surface of the sea, along with the four-stay sail, that is the front sail, the chip, the dinghy, and dinghies are small boats, and the main anchor, that is hook. So the spare hand pumps, four-stay sail, chip, dinghy, anchor, they were all floating on the surface of the sea. Why? Because the storm, when it hit the boat, everything that was on the deck had been thrown overboard. It was thrown, pulled violently out of the boat, and they were floating in water. Then I remembered we had another electric pump under the chat room floor. So he remembered that one more was there, electric pump, and it was in chat room. I connected it to an outpipe and was thankful to find that it worked. So he connected the one with outpipe and it started working. The night dragged on with an endless, bitterly cold routine of pumping, stirring, and working the radio. So the whole night they have to work endlessly with bitter cold. Why? It's month of January. And stirring Mary on the steering wheel and working the radio, trying to call. We were getting no replies to our Mayday calls. Mayday calls are student. It is an international radio telephone signal for help used by ships and aircrafts in distress. When there is a serious problem, they can use it. So they are working the radios to get connected to the world out so that some help can reach to them. But then it was not working. Why it was not working? We were getting no replies to our Mayday calls, which was not surprising in this remote corner of the world. Now it was not possible. First, they were all together in the remote area, the remote distance of the world. So there they could not, the radios were not working, the radio signals were not working, so no help could be reached out to them. Sue's head had swollen alarmingly. She had two enormous black eyes. So Sue's injury, it was getting dangerous because the eyes were altogether black. That is, it was swollen badly. And now she showed us a deep cut on her arm. And then she showed father that there was a cut also on the arm. When I asked why she hadn't made more of her injuries before this, she replied, "I didn't want to worry you when you were trying to save us all." So the father questions, "You did not tell me before." Daughter says that, "I don't want to worry my father when he's trying to save everybody and he's working bold and courageously to fight this situation and is trying to save everyone."